Greetings, students. Today, we are going to learn about one of USA's leading company, Berkshire Hathaway. Let us know this company in a much better way. Berkshire Hathaway, Inc. is an American multinational conglomerate holding company headquartered in Omaha, Nebraska, United States, that oversees and manages a number of subsidiary companies. The company wholly owns GEICO, BNSF, Lubrizol, Dairy Queen, Fruit of the Loom, Helzberg, Diamonds, and NetJets, owns half of the Heinz, owns an undisclosed percentage of Mars, Incorporated, and has significant minority holdings in American Express, the Coca-Cola Company, Wells Fargo, and IBM. Berkshire Hathaway averaged an annual growth in book value of 19.7% to its shareholders for the last 48 years, compared to 9.4% from S&P 500 with dividends included for the same period, while employing large amounts of capital and minimal debt. Berkshire Hathaway stock produced a total return of 76% from 2000 to 2010 versus a negative 11.3% return for the S&P 500. The company is known for its control by investor Warren Buffett, who is the company's chairman, president, and CEO. Buffett has used the float provided by Berkshire Hathaway's insurance operations paid premiums which are not held in reserves for reported claims and may be invested to finance his investments. In the early part of his career at Berkshire, he focused on long-term investments in publicly quoted stocks, but more recently, he has turned to buying whole companies. Berkshire now owns a diverse range of businesses, including confectionery, retail, railroad, home furnishings, encyclopedias, manufacturers of vacuum cleaners, jewelry sales, newspaper publishing, manufacture and distribution of uniforms, as well as several regional electrical and gas utilities. According to the Forbes Global 2000 list and formula, Berkshire Hathaway is the ninth leading public company in the world.
You probably have heard of Berkshire Hathaway because that's the company that Warren Buffett built his fortune with. Berkshire is a holding company conglomerate that buys shares of stock in consumer companies where customers make repeat purchases, companies like Coca-Cola, American Express, and Gillette. Berkshire Hathaway was actually started in 1839 as the Valley Falls Company, a textile company. And in 1929, it merged with Berkshire Cotton Manufacturing Company and was renamed Berkshire Fine Spinning Association. In 1955, it merged with Hathaway Manufacturing. And in 1962, Warren Buffett began buying Berkshire Hathaway stock. In 1964, he bought the entire company outright. And in 1967, he expanded into insurance, namely GEICO, and other investments and broadened his investment horizons. Interestingly, although Berkshire Hathaway was the investment vehicle for the world's wealthiest man to grow his wealth, he said publicly it was not his best investment. And in 1985, Berkshire Hathaway discontinued textile manufacturing altogether. In 2007, Berkshire Hathaway had an all-time high in its stock price of $150,000 a share. But in 2010, Warren Buffett publicly stated that buying Berkshire Hathaway was the biggest mistake of his career, and he would have had $200 billion more over the last 45 years if he had invested in insurance companies instead of in Berkshire Hathaway. In 2010, Berkshire Hathaway made history by entering into the Standard & Poor's 500, along with only 500 other companies in the United States. The annual shareholder meeting for Berkshire Hathaway is held at the Quest Center in Omaha, Nebraska each year. It's been called the Woodstock for capitalists. As a shareholder myself, I've attended, and it's unlike any other shareholder meeting I've ever been to. It's a weekend full of parties, barbecues, and Q&A time with Warren Buffett and his partner, Charlie Munger. You can even tour jets of one of the companies they own, NetJets. Any way you look at it, Warren Buffett and Berkshire Hathaway have left a footprint on the investment industry.
Berkshire Hathaway traces its roots to a textile manufacturing company established by Oliver Chas in 1839 as the Valley Falls Company in Valley Falls, Rhode Island. Chas had previously worked for Samuel Slater, the founder of the first successful textile mill in America. Chas founded his first textile mill in 1806. In 1929, the Valley Falls Company merged with the Berkshire Cotton Manufacturing Company, established in 1889 in Adams, Massachusetts. The combined company was known as Berkshire Fine Spinning Associates. In 2010, Buffett claimed that purchasing Berkshire Hathaway was the biggest investment mistake he had ever made, and claimed that it had denied him compounded investment returns of about $200 billion over the previous 45 years. Buffett claimed that he had invested that money directly in insurance businesses instead of buying out Berkshire Hathaway due to what he perceived as a slight by an individual. Those investments would have paid off several hundredfold. Berkshire's Class A shares sold for $140,803.06 as of January 4, 2013, making them the highest priced shares on the New York Stock Exchange, in part because they have never had a stock split and have only paid a dividend once since Warren Buffett took over retaining corporate earnings on its balance sheet in a manner that is impermissible for private investors and mutual funds. Shares closed over $1 lakh for the first time on October 23, 2006 and closed at an all-time high of $150 lakh on December 30, 2007. Despite its size, Berkshire has not been included in broad stock market indices such as the S&P 500 due to the lack of liquidity in its shares. However, following a 50-to-1 split of Berkshire's Class B shares in January 2010 and Berkshire's announcement that it would acquire the Burlington Northern Santa Fe Corporation, parent of BNSF Railway, Berkshire replaced BNSF in the S&P 500 on February 16, 2010. The current members of the board of directors of Berkshire Hathaway are Warren Buffett, Charlie Munger, Walter Scott Jr., Thomas S. Murphy, Howard Graham Buffett, Ronald Olson, Donald Q., Charlie Guyman, David Gottesman, Bill Gates, Steve Burke, Susan Decker, and Marilyn Mitmeri.
You know, you get a lot of praise, deservedly, as an investor and as a board member, but I want to begin by talking to you a little bit about your life as a CEO, because people forget that you are a CEO and an enormously successful one. So I thought I would begin by asking you about what makes a successful CEO, and particularly not just because you were successful, but because one thing I admire about you is that in your acquisitions, you know who is a successful CEO and you acquire the person as well as the business.
Yeah.
So what do you look for?
Well, we have a kind of a special kind of business because it's been built on buying businesses. We started with a textile business that was destined for failure 45 years ago. So Berkshire has been put together in a way that sort of fits me, but I also think it fits a successful business model. And I don't like committees. I don't like, there are all kinds of things I don't like, so I get rid of them and create a model that I think will work, but that doesn't have the things in it that I don't like. And as we've bought businesses over the years, and we now have 70-odd businesses, almost always the person who sells to me is the person who's going to be running it subsequently. And I'm handing them a lot of money, and they're handing me a stock certificate. And the next morning, they have to forget that they handed me the stock certificate. Basically, they have to still feel they own the business. So when I look at them, I look into their eyes and try and figure out whether they love the money or they love the business. And if they, everybody likes money, but if they don't love the business, I can't put that into them. If they're gonna, and so we have no contracts at Berkshire. We just don't have contracts. We count on people loving the business, and then my job is to make sure that I don't do anything that, in effect, kills that love of the business. We have CEOs that have never come to Omaha, and we've never had a meeting of them here. It just isn't the way we run. They knew how to run the business before I bought it. They're going to know how to run the business afterwards.
Well, that's not something you can tell from the balance sheet. That's something that you can tell from, I guess, the twinkle in their eye. And so that's something that you can only tell really from talking to them. Is that right?
Yeah, it really is. I mean, it's why we've never bought a single company of these 70-some from an LBO operator. I mean, they don't love the business. I mean, it's a vehicle to buy today and sell, many tomorrows from now. And they may dress up the accounting, and they may do leverage it up and that sort of thing. But they're thinking about, they have an exit strategy. We don't have an exit strategy. We have an entrance strategy, and that is it. Once, it's like a Catholic marriage. It's going to last forever.
Insurance and reinsurance business activities are conducted through approximately 70 domestic and foreign-based insurance companies. Berkshire's insurance businesses provide insurance and reinsurance of property and casualty risks primarily in the United States. Berkshire currently holds 89.8% of Mid-American Energy Holdings Company. At the time of purchase, Berkshire's voting interest was limited to 10% of the company's shares, but this restriction ended when the Public Utility Holding Company Act of 1935 was repealed in 2005. Berkshire claimed its favorite holding period is forever, yet it took billions in losses when it sold its position in ConocoPhillips, so it doesn't necessarily hold forever. Yet it tried to use this argument to avoid taking unrealized losses on the three stocks. On part of its Wells Fargo and Kraft holdings, it won its argument with the SEC and avoided write-downs on unrealized losses. It also had unrealized gains on parts of those positions. David Merkel of Aleph Block notes that comprehensive income factors in changes is unrealized capital gains or losses. If Berkshire Hathaway takes a write down, it reduces net income. But this does not change the result for comprehensive income because everything is marked to fair value already. Thus, one reconciling net income is comprehensive income pre and post the write down would notice that the adjustment is different by the amount of the write down. Hence, the corresponding credit to comprehensive income. That's the way the math works. Nothing wrong with it. So students, we went through the company's history to its present market scenario. Hope the information was useful to you. Have a nice day.